just a little bit behind schedule. I would like to get the afternoon session underway as soon as we can. I hope you enjoyed your lunch, but we've still got work to get through. Folks, while we're waiting to get started, and I am going to get started almost immediately, I still have that hotel key card, which no one has claimed, unless it's some elaborate game that someone's playing where you leave your key card for a stranger to pick up and then join you a little bit later. Well, sadly, you got me who picked it up, and I'm very happily married, so... But if no one claims it, I will take it back to the hotel a little bit later, and then you can explain yourself, but don't involve any of us. Folks, as you take your seat, and before we get started with the next panel, in which we look at opportunities and challenges in private debt and equity investments, let me say this. We've spent a fair amount of time this morning, haven't we, looking at risk and uncertainty. And it gave me a little frisson of pleasure over the lunch break when I do some work for a European radio station. And I was there was a live crossing I did because it's just been announced that France and Finland are going to be implementing in the European winter some degree of load shedding. And a call has been made by the European Union to cut electricity consumption by 10% during the course of the winter. And I was asked to give a situational report on what it's like in South Africa. And I think I can safely say now that South African load shedding has become an exportable commodity, which I think is a good thing. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Let's get started with our post-lunch session. It gives me pleasure to introduce our moderator for this session, Mark Colgate, editorial and strategy director for Asset TV. And he will be looking, as I say, about opportunities and challenge in private debt and equity investments, perhaps just to take the conversation that we had this morning in a slightly different direction and put perhaps a more positive spin on it. Mark, good to see you, and I will hand the stage over to you.
Jeremy, thank you very much. Well, good afternoon, everyone, and it's wonderful to have you here. It's a great privilege and pleasure to be here at the conference. Just to set the scene, I think this morning, obviously, we were covering a lot of the macroeconomic issues and then some of those risk and reward and asset allocation issues that are affecting pension schemes and pension funds in the round. The purpose of this session is to really drill down into one of those asset classes, private assets. And I think as well, as every scheme is different from each other, certainly with our panel, I'm very keen to drill down into the particulars of their scheme and how that affects what they're doing. Because a lot of these big ideas we've been hearing about this morning, in a sense, it's fine, it's theory, it's ideas, but they've got to be put into practice. And on the panel today, we have got a group of people whose job is to put a lot of that theory into practice. So let me introduce you to them. Closest to me, we have Richard Birugaba. He's managing director of the National Social Security Fund from Uganda. Next to him, we have Kabelo Rikotso. He's chief investment officer at the Public Investment Corporation. And completing our lineup, we have Aaron Kumar Vadivelu. He's senior investment officer at the International Monetary Fund. Now, I'm going to bring our panelists in a second, but just before I do, a little bit about how we're planning to structure today. We haven't got any PowerPoint presentations. So the idea, it's not that we're unprepared, we're just unstructured, which is very, very different. So the idea, I think, at the start is I want to start by finding out a little bit from each of our panelists about how they run their scheme and how they run the money, get a little bit of granularity around that. Then we're going to discuss some of the big issues and topics that are facing them in their schemes around private assets. And then we're going to open it up to you. It's very much your conference, so the more you're shaping the content, the better. So without any further ado, let's get things underway. Richard, let's start with you. Can you tell us a little bit about the NSSF? What's the day job? What are the specifics of the scheme?
Okay, so my official title is CEO. I'm meant to be a trustee, the chief trustee. but to be quite frank, I think I do a little bit more than that. So it's set up by government. It's a DC scheme. It's a provident fund. It pays out in a lump sum. We currently have two and a half million members, of which 70% are below the age of 30. The payout rules are that somebody can exit the scheme when they've attained the age of 55. However, they can also exit the scheme at the age of 50 if they have been out of employment for 1 year. And then the politicians were kind enough to change the rules during COVID because there was a huge outcry, and they've introduced a new exit, which is if you have contributed to the scheme for 10 years and you've attained the age of 45, you can exit with at least 20% of your benefit that has accrued within the period. So as you might have sort of imagined, the scheme value is about $4.5 and $5 billion. In Uganda terms, that's very big. We are about 10% of the country's GDP, and we are the largest scheme in the East African region. Quite well run on the admin side, but as I think the point I tried to make is that because we've got a huge population of under 30s, we've got a long period in which we need to invest in terms of matching the liability with the assets. And therefore, our investment strategy is quite important. And basically, for background, I suppose that's good. And then we'll talk a little bit about what we need to do to invest in order to cater for this very young population in a place where there are very few assets for us to be able to invest and give a return to our members. Because as you can see, you've got a long period. There is inflation, medium, it's been rising because of all the issues, but how do you protect that and give a real rate of return to your members by the time they get to their retirement? And that's the big issue.
Thank you. Richard, just one quick follow-up question. What exposure have you got to private assets in the fund, private equity, debt?
All right, so, you know, $4.5 million, 75% is in fixed income. About 14-15% is in equities and the rest is in alternates, most of our alternates in land. So our exposure to private equity is hardly 3%, but there are intricacies about it with the intricacies of the market. And I think that's what would be good to share with the rest of the team. So not a very big exposure, but that's because of the constraints of the market, but quite useful insights for people who are looking to expose themselves to that asset class.
Thank you. Cabello, let's bring you in here. Tell us a little bit about, because I think you've been in the job 4 months, so how was the first 100 days? What have you found? And what are the plans for private assets?
Thank you. Good afternoon, colleagues and all the esteemed guests. I think the first 4 months has been quite phenomenal. There's been a lot of growth. There's been a lot of problems we needed to solve. Given our history, but we also we were quite excited to look forward into investing into the future. So I've met a lot of my colleagues. I'd like to say that the quality of the people at the PIC is probably one of the best we have in the world. I think our board is exceptional and obviously led by Mr. Sithole. With regards to the book itself, I think you're looking at about 2.5 trillion rands. It used to be $150 billion, but in the last few weeks, with the rand depreciating, that number is closer to about $140 billion. Out of that, if you were to look at the whole allocation, I'd say the unlisted book in totality, including the money that we manage for GEPF, UIF, CC, and the other clients, say it's 96%, 95% it's invested in the listed markets, and about, say, 5% it's in the unlisted environment. So with regards to the size of the book on the unlisted environment, you're looking at about, say, just over 120 billion rands. We can convert it to dollars. If you divide by 17 and a half, you see it's not, it doesn't seem like a lot, but I would like to say that a typical private equity firm in this country, a large private equity firm, would manage 8 to 10 billion rands. We manage multiples of that. So it's split across debt and private equity. So pure equity, it's potentially about 34%, and the rest is in private debt. And the private debt book, it's we have senior term debt, we have term loans, we have subordinated debt, we have what we call SPV debt, where we fund BEE or entrepreneurs who come to us with an idea, or they would originate a transaction. They would say, they would come and say, PIC, we'd like to acquire company X, but we need funding. And a lot of these entrepreneurs are obviously black. Some are black and women, and very few with regards to youth. And in those cases, we would obviously structure the deal appropriately. So as the PIC, we don't want to be, we think we are an investor, we are a financier, we are a lender, but we are not an operator of companies. So ideally, we don't want to own significant majorities in businesses. So we'd like to just partner with others who can do it better than us. So that's sort of a high-level view of the PIC. We are not a DB fund or a DC fund, but actually we are an asset manager licensed with the FSCA, a CAT 2 license, we call it CAT 2A here in South Africa, licensed fund manager. So our job is to invest and hopefully stay out of trouble and make a lot of money for our clients. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for that. Arun, if I could bring you, tell us a little bit about the IMF pension fund.
We are from the IMF. I'm from the IMF investment office, and we manage two plans. One is a retirement plan. It's a defined benefit plan. Another is a post-employment benefit plan. And put together, we manage about $16 billion US dollars. And we are globally invested across 7 asset classes, and then 2 of which is real assets and alternate investments, we have private investments there. So the total private investment we have is about, I would say, 15% across these 2 asset classes. Now, our office, we just take care of the investment. The liability is taken care of by our HR department. So what is our goal? Our goal is simple. We have to make 5% return, 3% real across the market cycle. That's our long-term target. So what we focus is, we try to focus a lot on the portfolio construction. So build a resilient portfolio which can generate the 5% actuarial, 5% target return over the market cycle. So we emphasize a lot on the portfolio construction.
Thank you. And in terms of private assets, Aaron, is it across the whole capital structure in a similar way that the PIC is, or are you much more focused on equity than debt?
Sure. So in the alternate investments asset class, we have private debt, it's about 10%. We have a lot on the private equity, about 50 to 60% in private equity. And we have investments over leverage buyout, growth equity, and venture capital. And then the rest, about 40%, we have like a catch-all bucket, where when we have a unique idea or creative idea, so we just park it there. So that's how we have distributed the investment in the AI sector.
Thank you for that. Richard, coming back to you, we've heard a lot about the state of the markets, the state of the economy. Fundamentally, is now a good time for you as a pension or as a provident fund to be upping your weighting to private equity and private assets in general?
Okay, so the what's been happening, what's happening, what we appear to be happening is obviously interest rates are going up. And that means that there is a need to be able to position your assets in a way that you can beat inflation because of the rising inflation. So yes, to some extent, private equity is an asset class we are looking at, we've been looking at, to be able to hedge against inflation. The fact that our market doesn't have a lot of public or quoted companies on the stock exchange, because there's stock exchange is only not more than 30 years, and there's about 20-25 companies. So market capitalization is quite low. So you'll find that the opportunities that exist in the private equity space, which also gives those companies an opportunity to be able to prepare themselves for the listing. So, and also diversifying, because most of the companies that are on the stock exchange tend to be those in the financials. We got a little bit on the utilities side, but and telcos. So if you're looking for extra diversification in areas like agriculture, which for a long time hasn't attracted capital from the public area, so you know that seems to be a good area to concentrate on. The other thing that you can also say is that because of the ESG principles, where you're basically trying to bring some return around the environment, some return around the social side, creation of jobs, especially for our scheme, which is young and is recruiting a lot of membership, because initially we were a scheme that employs, that accepts people from the employment who are in the formal sector, and therefore if you want to create more jobs from the informal into the formal sector, you need to be able to help those companies that are in the private sector, and therefore investing in those companies. So really preparing them for coming onto the big stage. But in terms of return, because of the risks involved, the fact that there's a lot of work that needs to be done, making sure that there are specific funds to be able to invest in the private sector. So yes, I mean in the private equity space, and that would be a good opportunity for us.
Okay. Thank you. Capello, one thing when I was researching the PIC looking at news reports on it is I got a sense from journalists that everybody's got a view on where the money should go, and it's a bit like football, everyone's view is better, they've got a better idea of how to do it than the players on the pitch. When you're looking at private assets and where to invest, I mean, we'd heard a lot this morning about obviously this push to invest domestically and in infrastructure and so forth. What are some of the pros of that? What are some of the potential cons and red flags you've got to be careful of?
Okay, thank you for that. So I think the reality is that while we are a fund manager, we are a fund manager that is owned by the government. So if you are Alan Gray or Coronation next door, you probably will not attract a lot of opinion. But for us, given that we are an entity that is owned by the government, you should always expect for everyone to have an opinion. But largely what we are guided by, it's our mandate with the GEPF, UIF, and the other clients. And as investors, we try to stick to what that mandate allows us to do. And the other piece of legislation that is important is that the PIC has an act, which is very different to any other fund manager. So the PIC act would typically say, first of all, do what the client tells you to do, honor the mandate, invest as per their guidelines. But secondly, while you are delivering good returns for your client, ensure that you also promote financial sustainability, ensure that you promote job creation or job preservation, make sure that you promote local industrialization, manufacturing, and ensure that you are a good catalyst to the society. So when we invest at the PIC, what we are solving for is superior risk-adjusted returns from a financial returns point of view. But while we are doing that, we are also either minimizing bad societal outcomes or maximizing good societal outcomes in sort of all decisions that we make. So if you were to see a typical appraisal sheet that comes to the PIC that the deal makers, the ESG team, the risk team, and the other teams within the investments team that produce that appraisal report, in that front page, you will see it's not just the summary or description of an investment, but it's, yes, it's the IRR is important or the TMB is important, but what does it do for society? And because of that, we always have to ensure that the solution or the decisions that we end up with do both. And because of the society element, people have different views. Yeah.
I think if we call that roughly ESG, I think that's a topic we'll come back to and dig into a bit more detail, sustainable investing and ESG a little later. Arun, our other two panelists, Gabello and Richard, obviously doing a lot of their private asset investing in the local region or domestically. How does it work in your fund? The IMF's based out of, I think, Washington, D.C. So how do you work out what the home country is for the pension scheme, given how international it is? How does that affect the type of private assets you're investing in?
Sure. So I think before I answer the question, I think the most important thing is, what is the role of this asset class we have, the alternate investments? The way we think of alternate investment classes, it's basically not in competition with the public investments we do. It's more like whatever we cannot do in the public market, we try to do it in the private market. So that's how we think about it. So it's more of a completion strategy. And what we expect out of this asset class is an unrelated source of return. So it's a diversifier. And that's how we approach this. So put it simply, this asset class is not in competition with anything else. It's just like a complementary asset class. And in terms of how it has worked for us, we have been invested in this asset class for over 20 years, and it has done pretty well. I mean, when we look at the performance in the last 3, 5, or 10 years, this is the number one performing asset class. I was just trying to calculate the numbers, but yeah, it has done pretty good. I have to give a disclaimer here. My lawyers told me that whatever I say here is just my views, nothing to do with my institution, so I'll just throw it in there.
Thank you. Now, I think I'm going to ask one more round of questions, then I'm going to open it up to the floor. So be warned, and really looking forward to getting your questions and thoughts fed into this debate. The one question I do want to ask now is just how much inflation proofing you think you can get from private assets at the moment. And that's been such a big theme this morning. So Arun, can I start with you? Because you were talking about a scheme that's trying to get a 5% return, 3% real yield. So, but we don't seem to be in a world where inflation's 2% a year at the moment. So how much inflation linking can you get into some of those assets?
Sure. Now, when we look at inflation, I mean, if the inflations are going very high, I don't know how many places we have to hide. Probably the commodities are doing better. But in terms of alternate investment, as the inflation is going high, the interest rates are rising. We see lots of opportunities in the private debt space, especially in the direct lending. Because in the direct lending, it's floating rate exposure. So when the interest rate goes high, so the lender can actually pass on the higher interest rate to the borrower. So we do see some opportunities there. Are we going to do it? I think that's a different question, because we have a philosophical question there. Do we want to take illiquidity risk in private debt? So we're still debating about that question. Now, is this asset class inflation proof? I don't know, I don't think so, because the market risk, I think it will eventually catch up to this asset class. Probably it'll take some more time to show, I mean, for all the valuations to reflect that risk. So I think there is a time lag, but that risk is real for even for this asset class. That's how we see it.
Okay. Thank you for that. Kibela, can I get your thoughts on it? And also, we touched on diversification. What's the difference between true diversification and what's merely a lagged price? A lagged price from, the quoted equity markets do one thing. You look at your private exposure and you say, it's doing something very different. And then 6 months later, it all gets revalued and you find out it was doing something very similar to the private equity markets. The public markets.
Oh, okay, I think there's a... Remember the pricing for the unlisted side. Let's use private equity, I'll get to private debt. So on the private equity side, the pricing is largely based on comparables, based on what's happening on the listed side. So if you look currently, there was a slide deck shown earlier by one of the presenters showing that while the market has declined by 14 to 20%, the multiple of the market has not derated to a level that makes sense, which means now that if we want to go and acquire assets within the private equity space, those multiples are still quite high. So the pricing is still not at an attractive level because it just hasn't derated enough from the listed side. With regards to what we are seeing is that we tend to find that the unlisted side, because it's very close to the real economy, we get to see the pain the pain and the good in action within that market a lot quicker than what you are seeing on the listed side. So maybe let me use properties. So if you look at direct properties, and you look at the listed properties. So on the unlisted side, prices, yes, it's been tough. We've seen vacancies not being great. The economy has not been great, but most, whether it's office, industrials, or residential, we've seen a bit of an improvement in the past 2 years to not to 2019 levels, but to slightly below that, with office still struggling. But the valuation of those properties are now, every time they trade very close to NAV. So when you look at transaction values, it happens very close to NAV. Where else on the listed side, those property companies are trading at a 40, 50% discount to NAVs. So you can see the dislocation. The other thing, it's obviously that affects the listed side, but also the unlisted side, is that you have a huge broker community on the other side, on the listed side. So the price discovery, you could argue it's better, but in some cases, I would argue in listed properties, price discovery is not great there. On the unlisted side, unfortunately, every time when we have to transact, we look at what were the values over the last 6 months. It's a willing buyer, willing seller principle. Mostly, they trade at NAV. And I would say on the unlisted side, we know a lot more information as to what's happening in the real economy than what we would see on the listed side, purely because we are in the trenches.
Okay, thank you. Richard, could you share on the side of having, being very close to the those that you invest in directly via private assets, can you sort of share some of the insights as you talk to underlying investments? What shape are they in? How are they handling the inflation that we're seeing at the moment? And all the other pressures, not least the tail end of COVID.
So we tend to see two different factors driving the private market, which tend to be like the local conditions. So the demand in the market, and the liquidity in the market, as opposed to what you'd probably see in the public equity markets, which is largely driven by institutional investors and therefore what's happening in the international markets. So definitely, and the international markets tend to be driven by whatever is happening out there. So, if interest rates are going up in the rest of the world, then you will see that there's an exodus and therefore asset values go down. But coming specifically to the private assets or the private equity assets within the country. One of the biggest drivers has really been around taxation. So we've got this unfortunate situation where we've been trying to get the government to change the tax rules to allow the people who invest in private equity companies not. So if you invest through a fund, there is a double taxation element whereby you've got to allow for taxation of the company, but also taxation of the profits once they go into the fund. And therefore, a lot of companies have ended up having to list their companies or register their companies offshore in places like Mauritius or Seychelles, where they are tax havens to do that. So that does drive the price and can be influential on how we see the element going. The second one is around the markets, and we've seen that specifically in the agriculture sector, there's been a lot of demand for liquidity, and therefore making sure that those companies that are in that very specialized area, attracting those inflows, leads to an increase in the demand, and therefore we see that the pricing tends to be a little bit lower in there because of the extra demand that we're seeing in there. I think the other issues that we're also seeing within the local market is around we've had an oil discovery, and there's quite a lot of infrastructure requirement in the oil area, which unfortunately also coincides with where our tourism is. So there's been a little bit of a crash between the people who would like to keep the environment going and then also get the oil out of the ground. And therefore, there's been a little bit of compromise in terms of what to invest in that regard. But I believe that at the end of the day, we should see that protection on the local inflation being determined by the factors within the country rather than externally in the institutional investors.
Thank you. Well, we've had a bit of an overview of some of the issues at the moment facing private assets, and also each of these, particular to the individual schemes that are represented here today, or the fund management in the case of PIC, representing that invest on behalf of schemes. So I wanted to open this up to you as the audience. Have we got any questions? I know from this morning there's at least one private equity manager in the room. Don't tell me he used all three of his questions. Let's have a there's a question. Yes, please. If you wouldn't mind stepping up to the microphone, and you've got one. Thank you.
Hi, I'm the other private equity manager in the room. Samantha from Sonari Capital, and my question is, how do you think about the different investment strategies within private equity and private credit to the extent relevant? What's in flavor, what's out of flavor, and to what extent do you expect that to persist? So what are your focus areas and what are you avoiding?
Thank you very much for that. Cabela, let's come to you on that first. So, what are the favored investment strategies, both on the equity and on the debt side at the moment?
Yeah. So on the equity side, what we are seeing is that we are obviously trying to increase exposure to the defensive sectors. So healthcare, education, those sectors we are quite keen to increase exposure to. We particularly like agriculture. So it's another, it's one other sector that we want to increase exposure to. What we are avoiding, there's particularly, I wouldn't say there's any particular sector that we want to avoid because of our social side. But I'd say from a strategic point of view, we like agri, we want to increase our exposure into priority sectors, another asset class which have been spoken to widely, but this will be from the debt side, it's infrastructure. So we would like to fund tolls, we would like to fund bridges where we can, We think, obviously, we all understand the issues of electricity, but we think the next risk to this country is potentially water. So the whole value chain of how we get clean water into our classes, it's a sector that we would like to consider within SA. What I have not covered is that we also partner with third-party asset managers, and they also have their own ideas. So we also back third-party fund managers who would see opportunities in sectors that we may not necessarily see, and we are willing to back them. So I think that's we don't exclude. Thank you,
Richard. Let's bring you in on that. Yeah.
To say really three things: agriculture, agriculture, agriculture. But anyway, having said that, we're seeing quite a lot on the value chain side. So basically agriculture, but with a view to manufacturing. So basically increasing the value of agriculture rather than just producing it out on the farms and selling it onto the market. And related to that is the infrastructure that basically is going to be able to ensure that we have oil out of the ground, but also that we are able to deliver the products out of the gardens into the supermarkets.
On that, Richard, have you got an example? You mentioned the first of your agriculture examples. What's something that you're looking at or something that you've invested in that allows agriculture to scale up, be more efficient, find more markets?
Yeah, so one of the big sectors that we've done is in coffee. Uganda is either number one or number two coffee exporter in Africa. And for a long time, the prices obviously haven't been good. The commodity prices have gone up now, and therefore that's good for investment. But the issue has been that much of the agriculture in coffee has been around smallholder farms, which means that in terms of aggregation and getting it to the market, they tend to be very inefficient. So there's a lot of companies that are now beginning to look at that particular area in order to be able to aggregate and bring out a product that is done there. And therefore, we've been looking at that specific area and to bring it out. Of course, the other area has been in fishing. We've got the largest freshwater lake in Africa. And there's quite a lot of fish requirement out of the continent into places like China and Hong Kong. And therefore, there has been a big investment towards that area as well.
Okay. Thank you. Arun, if I can bring you in now, just your thoughts around investment strategies, both on the equity and the debt side that are in favor, and also if there's anything you're steering clear of.
So in terms of investment opportunities, I think before we look at the investment opportunities, so we look at our portfolio and see like what we have and what we don't have, and then what are all the missing pieces. We want to have a balanced exposure to everything, right? Because we don't know what the future is going to look like. So we want a balanced exposure. And also what it means is we want to extend our diversification, especially the geographic diversification. We have a lot of assets in North America. We are diversified. We have a lot of assets even in Africa. But we want to do more diversification. Specifically in terms of investments, I can just talk about a few strategies that we are looking at or we recently looked at. One, we all know like how expensive it is. I mean, the fee structure for private investments. So we were thinking like we are paying so much fee, like how can we benefit from it? So then what we did is we went and took, got into a fund, like it's more like taking a GP stake. So whenever there is a management fee paid by the other investor, so we get that management fee, it's a pass-through. And also when there is a performance fee, or as we call it as carried interest, we also get a portion of that. So we see that more like an fixed income alternative play, that's one. And the second is, liquidity, there is a lot of liquidity risk here. If the public market is going to continue to sell off, a lot of investors might get into liquidity issues. And if that happens, is it possible that they want to offload some of this investment in the secondary market? Maybe. If that's going to happen, If that's going to, if the assets are going to be sold at a discount, do we have a lot of liquidity so we can take opportunity of that? So that's something that we think about. And another thing that we constantly work with the manager is, all the managers come with this term, I mean, pretty much all the managers, which is 10 plus 2. It's pretty much the life cycle of the fund is 10 years, and it can be extended by 2 more years, irrespective of what sector it is, what geographic location it is. It doesn't make a lot of sense to us, and so we started questioning that, because we are not in this business for IRR or anything. We want wealth creation. We want to accumulate wealth. If that's the case, how do we compound the return? Can we go into a more permanent structure capital, right? Can we invest in a structure where we are not bound by this 5 years investment period and 5 years of harvesting period? Because when we talk to the manager, they do say that they have very good assets, but because the fund is going to end, they have to sell it. Half the time, they themselves create the next fund, like fund 2, fund 3, fund 4, and then keep on rolling all this investment. We are like, why do we have to go through that? If there is a good asset, it's hard to buy or hard to get. Why don't we just hold it for a much longer period? And also in the similar note, like we talked about energy transition this morning as well. When we talk about the energy transition, the overall life cycle, if you talk to any manager, they say it's about 30 years period. The energy transition is going to take about 30 years. But even their fund, the investment period is like 4 to 5 years. Yeah, like if the energy transition is going to take like 30 years, why can't we structure the fund in a way that we stay invested for a much longer period? Of course, have a liquidity portion where we can liquidate, like say every 2 years there is a liquidity event. If we want to increase the allocation or decrease the allocation, we can get in. But we are actually fundamentally questioning why pretty much all the investments are like 10 plus 2. So these are some of the things that we think about.
Arun, thank you for that. Just as a quick follow-up, and then I'll bring Kapila in. When you get to that situation where there's a fund and it's coming to the end of its life, but embedded in it is still a 25-year asset that you think is rather good, I don't want to be generous with your money, but aren't you tempted to just buy it?
See, what is the structure to buy it? Now, in a fund, let's say a fund has this asset, it's a valuable asset, like what options do they have? Now, for the manager to get the performance, the carried interest, they have to sell the asset. So they have multiple ways. They either go to an IPO, right, or they sell it to another, let's say, a company, or they sell it to another fund, or it can be their own fund. But basically, that transaction does happen, right? So our question is, why should that transaction happen? Now, to solve this problem in the industry, they're coming with the continuation fund, and we have some issues with that too. How do we know it's the good assets that are rolled up to the continuation fund? How do we know it's the assets that maybe it's not a good asset manager, maybe they don't want to sell it in a lower valuation and they're just like moving it? So those are the type of things we think about.
Sorry, Cabello, I cut across you there, my apologies. Sorry, I cut across you. I think you, did you want to come back in on something that Arun was saying?
No, I really just wanted to support Arun here. So if you take a school, so if you are going to build a school, you need to put in the life of a child in a school in this country is 13 years. So you would start with a grade R to what we used to call it as standard 2, so grade R to say grade 4. So that cohort, when you build a school, you build, you fill it up with a lot of kids aged between, say, 7 and 10 or 11 years old. But unfortunately, you can't build the higher primary, and you can't build a high school. So how you're going to build it, it's a stacked process. You build for the little ones when they become 11 years old. You make sure that you build for them what we used to call a higher primary, and eventually you build what is now a high school. So you build as they grow, but that's 13 years. So any expectations of high returns prior to 13 years, just forget about it. Does it mean we don't build schools and invest in schools? You can see it's not in the 10-year time frame of even a typical private equity fund. So we have to be flexible with regards to the structures that we use. There are permanent capital structures that we need to consider now going forward. But with those types of investments, also there were earlier discussions about infrastructure, a REIPP, what we call the Renewable Energy IPP program. The takeoff is a 20-year takeoff, but somebody has to put in capital before that. So if you're not prepared to put down the capital and wait for your return to only come, potentially recover your money in year 11 or 12, and get your returns from year 13 to 20, you can see again, that's not a typical 10-year plus one time frame. So that's what I just wanted to add to Arun's discussion, to say we need to be a lot more flexible, and you will see that us as the PIC, that's why I said we like social infrastructure, we like renewable energy, we like those assets. We understand it's a gap that the asset managers on the private side cannot necessarily play because they are not given a 20, 25, or 30-year fund.
Well, Richard, given the nature of your fund, does that mean you're able to take a long-term time frame and underwrite risks that the private markets can't?
To a lesser extent, the nature of our fund on the private side we've just done 10 years, maybe a little bit longer, and exit back into the fund, which then means that we look for another area to go in. But one of the issues actually we've had is exits. How do we exit in the business? And most of it has been, we had anticipated that most of it would be through the stock exchange, but it appears to be like most times the private owner tends to buy back their own share. And that tends to limit our opportunity of even expanding it. But on the whole, yes, it's just in the midterm rather than in the long term.
Thank you. Now, I know there was a question, there's a gentleman over here.
Good afternoon. My name is John Oliphant, the chairman of Third Way Asset Management Group. I've got more specific questions predominantly for Mr. Rikhotso, given the size and the role you play in the economy. The first question is, there's a growing trend of delistings from the JSE. And obviously, most pension funds have a big allocation towards listed equities. Is there a big concern from the PIC, and what are you doing about it to encourage more listings as opposed to delistings, for example? And then two, the second question, the Minister of Finance in his opening remarks this morning, he said that if somebody is coming to ask for money and you're raising 100 million and a bank says you need to put skin in the game, I also understand it's also a policy of the PIC. Would you please give us a sense of when you're gonna remove that requirement so that we can also be empowered? And then the last question, I think there's been a almost like a false start of SPACs in South Africa, special purpose acquisition companies. I've been fortunate to have listed two of those, but obviously that sector is struggling. Is there a way that, maybe from the panels we can learn, maybe from the IMF, how in the US they are successful, but here on the continent, we're battling to get the specs going, and what is it that can be done to encourage that trend? Because that's another way of raising funds, which sits somewhere between unlisted and listed. Thank you.
John, thank you very much for those questions. Capella, we better come to you on that first. Can I take the second question first on the skin in the game? Sorry, I didn't mean to be a hospital pass, but...
the skin in the game, to be honest, the motivation is just to show that as you back an entrepreneur, that they are aligned with you as a shareholder. So typically, if you go to a bank and you want them to fund your vehicle or your house, they would say put down 5-10% a deposit, whatever that number is. So it's not, unfortunately, when it comes to very large transactions, If somebody comes with a billion rand deal and we request a 5% capital allocation, which is skin in the game on their part, it's 50 million rand, which is unfortunately out of reach for 99% of people in this country. So that part, we need to just find creative ways to do it. You could potentially just put in a pref structure that sweeps the earnings before the entrepreneur gets their dividend, but I think we need to just solve for it. So it's something that we are aware of, John, and we are currently discussing it internally. I know the Minister of Finance has raised it with me several times to say, but what are you doing on supporting BEE? We shouldn't let it go. Transformation is a key pillar of what we do, and we will have to solve for it. So that's one on the skin in the game. With regards to delistings, so delistings, there is a strategic discussion that we are currently having even at IC level, but there is also an operational discussion. So from my side, if my team comes to me and says, Mediclinic is delisting, the offer price is 60% above the 90-day VWAP, and maybe it offers a great premium to what we thought we were going to get over the next year, you'll have to let the team make the decision to say, you have a DOA, if you think it's a good deal, you support it, you let them do it. On other cases, if there is a delisting where we don't support it, we will block it. Because essentially in this country, I don't think there is a delisting that can happen without the PIC support. So we own 15 to 20% of companies listed on the JSE. So that's one element from a fund manager point of view. But from a strategic point of view, the delistings obviously creates concentration risks for us as the PIC, for GEPF, for UIF, and our other clients. And it also reduces the opportunity set for our portfolio managers. So that discussion has to happen with the JSE. We have to find a way to promote delistings if the regulatory environment is such that it's so first world class that it doesn't allow, it's just too costly for companies to remain listed, then we need to solve for it. But I'd like to say the other key issue that has also led for it, you should listen to some of the small mid-cap firms that have delisted, and one of them is Long for Life. But if you listen to the webcast of Brian Joffe, why they had to delist Long for Life, the pain was that it's just too costly to remain listed. There is no one looking at us. I want to raise capital, but I can't raise it because the broker community has literally disappeared. And there is a reason why that happened. You could argue it was MiFID, but for some reason, if you don't have the broker community, especially your large brokers looking at your particular share, you're going to struggle. And as an investment holding company or any company, you will trade at a huge discount and you will not understand why. So that's on the delistings side. So that one we need to have lots of discussions with the JSE, but they also need to come to the party. We are ready to engage and support and assist, but we need to just find that one. On the specs, so the specs, if you recall, in the US, actually, in the last 2 years, anyone was raising a spec for something, it was a spec party. Any person who is known could raise a spec, say, give me $1 billion, I'm going to invest in hotels. You saw there's quite a few that came through, especially in the first half of last year. And what we have seen is that a spec is just the promise to say, here's 500 million rands, or here's $1 billion, I'm going to invest in hotels, or I'm going to invest in renewable energy projects and those things. But the reality is that some of these people who were raising these specs, maybe they did it because the motivation could have been the fees. But if you look at, do we have a successful spec that has become an investment holding company? Because remember those specs, you have to be a spec for probably 2 years. Within 2 years, you need to invest so that you become an investment holding company. So I think the delivery there, not in all, but in some cases, it could have been abused, and it has led to obviously the current challenges. The other thing, John, is that those specs, if you are a 500 million rand spec, you are way too small again. You are on the, it's not even a small cap, it's like a micro cap. So you are sitting within the listed environment, but no one is looking at you. So even if you take the whole 500 you invested, your market cap can only be 500. For you to grow, you need to actually go and raise capital at the banks, find other deals, and bulk up your portfolio. And unfortunately, there hasn't been, in the last 2 years, I don't want to say this, but there hasn't been a lot of funding and lending from financial institutions. So as the PIC, we've just said, we are gonna have to be, in some cases, the last man standing, because there are certain industries that we just have to support. If we don't support them, then who else is going to do it? So we take your I heed you and understand exactly what you're coming from. But that's been the challenge. That has been the challenge. Maybe they need to merge to become bigger, but that also hasn't happened.
Thank you. I want to get some. Yes, absolutely.
I want to just compliment a few of the points Kabelo was mentioning. Now, when we look at the how the listed companies in the public market has evolved, I mean, I think whatever number the listed companies we have is only half of what it used to be 20, 25 years back, at least in US. And I think that's a similar trend in Africa as well. And if you look at a lot of these companies that disappear, to your point, I think most were small cap and the micro cap companies, right? So now, what was one of the main drivers? It's the private capital. Most of them were going private. One of the discussion we have with some of our public equity manager is they focus on all the large and medium cap, but there are also small and micro cap, right? And those are the potential targets for some of the GPs. So why can't the public equity managers look at some of this opportunity? So create a vehicle in the public market that will give private-like return. So we actually did that with one of the managers a few years back, and it's pretty good. So the focus is more like target on the small companies, which has a lot of characteristics of the private company, but it is still in the public space. We know the liquidity is not as good as large cap, but still it is not as bad as in the private investment. So that's our thinking. And 2 weeks back, I was in India, and then the number of listed companies, over 6,000 companies, but pretty much all the asset managers, they focus on the top 500 or 600 companies. So we were asking, like, why are you ignoring the rest of the space? Can you find us an opportunity, build a portfolio that will give us private-like returns in the public market? And one more point on the SPAC. We don't have any investment in SPAC because, in our view, we don't fully understand the risk and the value add that's actually coming there. So we try to keep ourselves away from any SPAC investment.
Yeah. As the PIC, along with the GEPF, sort of what we've agreed, not agreed, but what we had proposed to our largest client was that let's not be so categorical whether something is listed or unlisted. So for us, if there is an opportunity to remain invested in some of these delistings, we will hold them. But we obviously need permission from the clients. But the view is that an investment is an investment, a good business is a good business, whether it's listed or unlisted. As the GEPF, there is no, they are along with the UIF and other clients, they are in a very fortunate position to still choose to hold some of those companies that may be delisting.
Thank you for that. Richard, can I get your thoughts? In fact, I want to recycle a question from this morning. There was a lady in one of the morning sessions who was talking about the governance side of pension schemes, and I think one of the implications was if trustees didn't feel they were completely au fait with new asset classes, they would tend to steer away from them. So when, given what you were saying earlier about perhaps the gap between listed and private assets being, well, they're closer to each other perhaps in Uganda than they would be if you were in the States or a much bigger, deeper, more liquid market. Culturally, how easy is it to get a board of trustees and the governance around private assets to go from a listed market to the unlisted space?
Am I on record? of course, I'm with friends, right? It's very difficult. I mean, it's very difficult. Obviously, skill set is very, very important. I mean, we don't have that many trustees who understand these instruments. So because of the fact that we, you know, our board of directors, our trustees tend to be nominated by government and they come from the, we got three sort of tripartite arrangement where government, the workers through their unions, and the employers through a federation of employers tend to provide us with those trustees. So we do have difficulty in finding people with the right skill set to be able to navigate through this very complicated market. So, I mean, you would say that although the markets tend to be similar, both in the private and the public sector, but certainly you do need skill sets to help you navigate the private markets, especially on the equity side.
Thank you. Right, now let's keep an eye out for, have we got any more questions? There must be some more. Let's have a look. We've got about another 20 minutes of our session. Not at the moment. You're answering everything, anticipating and answering pretty much everything. I think one of the things that we've talked about has been liquidity and fees. Aaron, I mean, you've touched on fees. Could you, I suppose we've seen a rise in private assets, Aaron. Perhaps it's no coincidence, it's coincided with the bull market. And it's easier to pay fees when everything's going up 10, 15, 20% a year. Could you give us your thoughts on what the fee pressures are in private assets at the moment? What sort of direction you're seeing, what sort of pressures you're seeing, how that's affecting, you know, what you're buying?
Sure. The fee is, of course, very high in private investments. So the usual term is like 2 and 20, which is 2% management fee and 20% performance fee. Now, the question is how much bargaining power do we have as an investor? I don't think we have a lot. We have a little, but not a lot, because there is so much demand for this private investment. So when we get into a tough negotiation, it's very hard to sometimes get a favorable fee for us. Now, I think the way to look at this is, if, let's put it this way, if there is a good value add, then it's okay to pay the fee. I think then it's easy to justify all the high fee we are paying. But the real challenge comes if we cannot justify the value add for the fee we pay. I think just to give some perspective, let's say we have a $1 billion fund. We're just the only investor. We have a GP relationship. Let's say the manager in the 10-year made us $1 billion. So the $1 billion became another billion. If you look at the fee that we are going to pay to that manager, it's, I don't know, it'll be in the upwards of $350 million, right? So we made a $1 billion fine, it looks good, but we are also paying the manager $300, $400 million. How do we justify this? If we can justify it, let's say, if they have performed well above the public equity, right? If we can clearly show there is an illiquidity premium and there is a good diversification benefit, all of that, then I think it's easy to justify. The real trouble is if the manager is not performing and if you have to still pay all this fee, then it's difficult, right? So that's why selecting the right manager is one of the critical things. So because imagine this way, right? When in this example, we are committing $1 billion And we are committing for what, like 10 plus 2 years? And once we sign the contract, once we commit, there is only so much we can do as an investor. So there is a lot of work that has to happen upfront. That's why it takes a lot of time to do all the due diligence and negotiate all the terms and conditions and come out with, to select the manager. I think if we select the right manager, then I think it's an easy story. If we don't do a good job in selecting the right manager, then it's going to be difficult. And I don't know if I can say this. One other thing that we are just observing, I don't think there's a research or anything, but most of the people who do the investment, or let's say who do this private investment, may not be even there working with that firm to even see after 10, 12 years how it performed, right? So that's where I think the governance becomes really important. So we do all the upfront due diligence and work, and that's where it gets very difficult. I think the point is there is an opportunity set. We can add a lot of value. I think when we add value, it's okay to pay that money. But if we select the wrong manager, it's a difficult conversation to have with our governing body.
Thank you. Rich, can I get your thoughts? How do you help try and keep cost under control, whether that's from third-party funds or if it's internal research you're doing? Make sure you're properly resourced, but not over-resourced.
Unfortunately, that's one area which we continue to suffer largely because of supply. I mean, there aren't that many people with the expertise. So yes, cost does become a big part of looking at the transactions. I suppose with the maturity, more businesses and more transactions happening, the cost will come down and more advisors coming in. But yeah, that is a problem at the moment because of the volumes not being sufficient to cover the costs. But we try and negotiate, to try and get good. I mean, the 20 and 2% is the same sort of structure that we use on our GP on the fund. We've got to negotiate because largely there isn't much more that the fund managers will do in terms of going forward.
Thank you. Gabella, get your thoughts around fees and how you make sure you're getting value for money.
So on fees, we approach it slightly differently. So if in a space where, so we have different fund managers that we would allocate to, some are very small and we want to incubate them so that they can grow larger businesses. So in those cases, we will probably be 50, sometimes 100% investors in those businesses, or we would initiate the business from day one. In those circumstances, we want to ensure that the business is viable. So the 2 and 20, we will accept it because it's a small firm and we want to see them being successful. With the larger companies, we obviously then negotiate very hard for what we believe is fair for our clients. So on the listed side, we negotiate hard. I think there are some managers in the room. I can't disclose the fees, but we know we don't like to overpay there. It's important. So, but we will pay what is fair for the right service. With regards to performance fees, ideally we'd like our managers to have performance fees so that every time when we show performance to our clients, we can say, yes, they were paid X, but look what they've delivered. And we hope most of them will deliver good returns for us. So that fee pressure will remain for many, many years to come, but we have to be pragmatic because from a transformation point of view, we want to grow our black asset managers, and on that basis, I personally don't believe we need to squeeze them, especially in the early years of the business. But at some point, if they are large enough, they are sustainable, then we can have a seat around the table to discuss the fees to be in line with their larger counterparts.
Right. Thank you. Arun.
Points. One is we can do fund of funds. I think that's part of your question. There is an additional fee component to the fund of funds. So on top of the 2 and 20 fee, if you're going with fund of fund, they do a lot of work on behalf of us, but they will also charge 1 and 10 on top of the 2 and 20. So that's something we should remember. And also, there are other ways we try to keep the cost low, which is, we talked about the permanent capital vehicle, right? So it's for a longer duration. If that's the case, 2 and 20 is too much. So in those structure, we have actually massively reduced the fee. And we are also exploring the co-investment opportunity, because there the fee is less, but that requires a different sort of skill set and we have to move very fast, so we are exploring that option. There is a good side of paying this lot of fee though. There is a good alignment of interest. Because the managers, the 20% is the performance fee. Actually, that's where they try to make most of their money. So they really try to work hard to actually make sure that the performance is really good for us. So that brings some amount of alignment of interest. So it's not all negative. And one more question which we sometimes get is, yeah, the private investment, the returns are good, but if we lever up S&P 500, there is a lot of leverage in the private investments. If you lever up public equity, we can actually get that sort of return. I mean, it's true, we can debate. But that's when I think we have to focus on the diversification benefit that comes from the private investment. And the last point is, we do see there is a lot of fee that we pay, and that's why we are starting to take more GP stake. So whenever, so what this fund does is it goes and takes GP stake in a lot of other funds. So when these GPs get a lot of fee, as an investor, we get that back. So there is a, we can take advantage of that as well. So there are options.
Okay, thank you.
Can I?
Yes, of course, please.
Can I ask a question? When I look at the Netherlands, the Dutch funds, there's a lot of discussion about fees. And I think it's an illusion to, let's say, massively change the fee structure in the industry. But what we see is that trustees say, well, indeed, your returns were wonderful, but we still find it very difficult to explain to our plan members that we paid an individual manager this amount of money. As a result, a lot of divestments from hedge funds, and the discussion is still on the table regarding private equity. Indeed, as you said, in combination with the discussion whether it is levered public equity in many cases. So take an honest look at where the returns come from. But I wondered whether it's not a question yet. Would you have similar discussions here? Is it about fees and, let's say, having to explain why you pay these fees and that it's actually a valid remuneration?
Ona, thank you very much for your question. Okay. But could you give us some thoughts on that, on value for money and how you explain it to the wider membership of pension schemes?
So typically, let's say let me start with hedge funds. So on the hedge fund industry, what has occurred there was that, yes, it's a, what has been established was that the beta that you're buying, you're getting equity beta, but you're paying enormous amounts of fees. So that has been, you would have seen in the past few years that a lot of these hedge fund managers had a long equity bias, and it was basically playing leverage on, let's say, the S&P 500 or the Eurodex, and that created a bit of an issue. And if you have a market that is just going up and they have leverage on it, most of them are tended to do well. What was critical was that that industry still needs to show that it adds diversity to a public listed equity portfolio. So if they can show that, hopefully you will see it pick up. But in South Africa, I mean, that industry has gone, I think it's about 40 billion rands now. It's very tiny, and it doesn't seem to be growing. So there, it was very hard because you couldn't distinguish what exactly were these managers different or offering different to the public listed equity side. Private equity is very different. So in a private equity business, you have to, most of these guys, as much as they are investors, but every week they must either go to the company. The costs involved in running an operation, it's quite enormous. So let's use large buyout firms. So they buy the company, they control it, they select the board, they ensure that the board has a strategy, they even appoint and hire the CEO, CFO, COO, and every week they have a timeline to check whether is this company on track. It costs a lot of money because you are always, besides the accounting part, but there's also always issues you need to resolve. So if I look even within the PIC team, we will always need quite a lot of people in managing the 120, 150 investee companies that we manage, because they take time. There's legal fees involved, there is time involved, there's a whole lot of things involved. So that model in itself, it just lends itself in being slightly costlier, because you actually don't really get economies of scale. So for every company that you add on the books within as an investee company, you almost need to ensure that you add resources to keep up with it. Because you can't have two people or 10 people looking at 150 investee companies, looking at management accounts, looking at the books, making sure the strategy is correct, making sure the Fs are correct, and talking to suppliers, customers. It's inherently an expensive model, but maybe the 220 could be high. But I just think from what we've seen, for AUM of below 1.5 billion rands, I don't think you need to. These guys are not making a killing. The carry is what they will make as money, but at those levels, it's not high. And remember, a 1.5 billion rand fund, let's say a mid-market fund, 1.52 billion, it's still going to have 12 companies, investee companies inside. And sometimes these teams is three or four people working hard to sweat the asset, but the 2% basically just pays off for the lights and the rent, but it doesn't do much because they are small. If it was a 10, 20, 30 billion rand fund, then you can talk about adjusting the 2%.
I have a few more things. We are actually very aggressive when we negotiate fee. So there are investments where we didn't invest because for about 5 years because we didn't like the fee. So if the fee is too much, it can be actually a showstopper for us. And also, there are a lot of nuances within the contract that we can negotiate, but also how much negotiation power we have, that also comes into picture. For example, when we talk about the performance fee, we say it's 20%. A lot of times there is a hurdle there that the manager has to beat that 8% is the typical hurdle, that they have to perform more than that 8% to get the performance fee. The nuance comes in when you see there is another clause called catch-up. So after they outperform that 8%, let's say they perform 10%, are we going to pay them the performance fee for that additional 2% or for the 10%? So these are the nuances that we have to look carefully in the contract and then see if we have room to negotiate. And also, I think it's also a demand problem. If you look at all the investors, basically we are all chasing the top managers, right? So the demand for them is huge. So how much bargaining power do we have? If we have a huge check, then probably we have a lot of bargaining power. If not, then it gets difficult. And also on the operational cost, there is a lot of operational cost, but that's another nuance we have to take care of within our contract. Or what cost is going to be passed over to the investors versus what cost is going to be covered within their management fee. Okay. So when we negotiate the terms and conditions, we have to be careful in what goes in there. And that's where we spend a lot of time. It's not about just getting the investment done, that's the easy part, but going through the due diligence and all these terms and conditions to see if there is any loophole, are we completely protected? It takes a lot of time. And there are investments where we worked for like over a, close to a year, and then we couldn't get the terms we want, and then we are like walked out. Because that's how we don't incentivize anyone just for closing an investment or a deal. At the end of the day, we have to do what is best for the plan, because our capital is precious for us, and we are here in for a long game, wealth creation. So there are like certain conditions we don't budge.
Thank you for that. I think, Irene, you and Cabela have covered the extraordinary amount of work that gets involved for the fees. So Richard, I want to bring you on a slightly different angle. You may be able to justify the fees to yourself, but how do you justify them to the membership? Times are tough, and you see a big headline fee. How do you explain that to all
investors? Yeah, I think that's the issue, getting to explain that. But I think, as everyone has said, it's the issue around the return that you're getting out of it that maybe you're able to justify it. And the added problem that you do not have that many opportunities in there. But I think one of the things that I can really identify is that it is hard work. It takes a lot of time. The deals take so much time, and you know our own time on the investee companies and having people on the boards, making sure that everything is going according to plan, does increase the cost. But as I said, if the returns are good, which they have tended to be because of the particular part of the market, then it is justifiable.
For that. Now, we've got about 5 minutes left before our break, so if anyone's got a final question. Four minutes, okay. If anyone's got a short, sharp final question, let us know. No? Okay, it's a good job I had. Here's one I prepared earlier. I think just to pull this together as a bit of debate. I mean, we've been talking a lot around current issues, what's happening in the market at the moment, but my final question or challenge to each of you is, what's one thing that we're not talking about today in the world of private assets that you think could be a big issue in 3, 4, 5 years' time? So we're all focused over here. What's something that's just beginning to bleep on the radar screen? Who should we come to? Cabela, you're nodding, so I'm going to come to you first on that.
Yeah. I think the biggest gap we are missing, I would say, on the South African side is just the promotion of the venture capital industry. So we are all looking at very large deals, very large transactions, but I think it's an area that we need to just try and re-engage and vitalize a bit more. It's very vibrant in London, in San Francisco, in the US, but it's just something that has not picked up properly here. And I would say if you look at the makeup of our portfolio, it's one area where I would we need to just get more of those, because you are funding the youth that we've spoken about. They are the ones who will come up with very fancy ideas with regards to fintech. We have not spoken about fintech, but if you maybe just the stat is that in the past year, fintech in Africa attracted 40 to 45% of the capital. But if you look on our asset allocation, it's zero. So it's an area we know it exists. It's largely funded by high net worth individuals and family offices, but we are not that yet. We are not playing in that space in a way that we should.
Thank you. Richard.
So one of the most asked questions to me back home is what keeps me awake at night? And my answer tends to be, a 13-year-old, 14-year-old, 15-year-old young man, lady in her, his mother's, father's, parents' backyard, coming up with an app that totally disrupts our business model, which I think could happen, in spite of the fact that there is a law that says you've got to contribute to the NSSF. So one of the things we've done to try and tap into that area is we've created an innovation fund, basically which allows small businesses, the ones that Capello said are not under the radar of anybody, to try and see if they can come up with clever ideas of disrupting things and creating a new possibility. And I think that because they tend to be small, they tend to be ignored, they tend to be very futuristic, nobody believes in them. And we've actually put out money to be able to fund, especially the piloting stage. So I think if that's the area that has been missed out, I would say that that is it. But we've tried to do something to see if we can really develop that area to really come up with big businesses and big ideas, which then change the way life happens and therefore create a value as a business.
Thank you. So we've got the development of venture capital, innovation, particularly amongst the young. Arun, a final thought from you.
I know we talked about opportunity. Let me just think about the risk. Are we thinking about the liquidity risk properly, right? Because if you look at the private investment, when you read the report, we can say the dry powder is $1 trillion. What it means is the manager can ask the investors to basically call the capital of $1 trillion, right? Now, let's say we have 15% of private investment. Already the public markets are selling off, so the proportion of private investment is increasing. And top of it, if the managers start calling all the capital, now we have to, it's a contract obligation, right? So we have to pay. Now, already the public market is sold or it's declining. Do we want, how are we managing the liquidity? We don't want to be in a forced selling position, right? So that's where we focus that even in the alternate investment, there has to be some liquid portion or liquid investment to manage this risk properly. And if you ask the final thought, let me put it this way. I think whatever we know, it's already in the past. The future, we don't know, right? We have to focus on building a resilient portfolio. That's, I think, that's our focus. I think we will continue to do that. There are a lot of opportunities. There are a lot of challenges in the private investment. I think the real skill is how do we navigate all these challenges to take care of the opportunity. And that being said, I think we should also be humble to say it's not just all skill. We need luck. And I believe that luck favors long-term risk-taking. And in that note, I wish you all the best luck.
Thank you very much. We have to leave it there. So I'd like to say thank you to you for all your questions and your challenges to the panel. I'd like to thank our fantastic panelists for sharing all their expertise, experience and enthusiasm with us. So perhaps you could join me in thanking our panelists. Thank you very much indeed.
And Mark, thank you for leading the panel so successfully, for the insightful questions, and we really do appreciate it. Ladies and gentlemen, we are right on time. I'm going to give you 10, 15 minutes or so just to stretch your legs. I think there is a cup of coffee outside. And then I would like to try, if I can, to bring this all in on time. So our final keynote this evening will be at about 4:15. I will make an announcement to get you back as soon as possible. But in the meantime,